I want to begin something on the lighter side. Pulled this one from the archive. It was a parishioner who raised this up with me and thought it was important. One day while he was at the track playing the ponies, all but losing his shirt, Mitch noticed a priest who stepped out onto the track and blessed the forehead of one of the horses lining up on the fourth race. Praise be to God. Before the next race, he hadn't had a lot of luck. So here he comes, and lo and behold, the horse won the race, and the horse was a long shot. Mitch was struck by this. This is good news, he said. So the horses arrived, setting up for the fifth, and sure enough, the priest made a blessing on one of the forehead and one of the horses. Mitch made a beeline to the betting window, placed a small bet on the horse. Again, even though it was another long shot, the horse the priest had blessed won the race. Whoa. Mitch collected his winnings. He was thankful and anxiously waited to see which horse the priest would bless. On the sixth race, the priest again blessed the horse. Mitch bet on it big, and it won. Mitch was elated. As the races continued, the priest kept blessing long shot horses, and each one ended up coming in first. By and by, Mitch decided he was going to pull all his money out of his bank account, runs to the ATM, and just pulls it all out, waited for the priest's blessings that would tell him which horse to bet on. True to his pattern, the priest stepped out onto the track for the last race. He blessed the forehead of the old nag that was the long shot of the day. But Mitch also noticed that the priest also blessed the eyes and the ears of this horse, the hooves of the old nag. Mitch knew he had a winner and bet every cent on her. Well, he then watched dumbfounded as the old nag, sure enough, came in last. Mitch, in a state of shock, made his way down to the track, turned to the priest. He said, "Father, what happened? And all day long you bless horses and they keep winning. And then in this last race, the horse you blessed lost by a Kentucky mile. Now, thanks to you, I've lost every penny." And the priest nodded wisely and with sympathy. He said, "Son, the problem with you Protestants is you don't know the difference between a simple blessing and last rites." I don't know what to do other than to say, you know, how does that build into what I want to talk about today? Okay. What's it got to do with anything? I think one of the things it's got to do is that we think we know stuff, but we don't. We think we got it down, but we don't. So I want to speak to that today. And today's sermon, I would chalk up as, for me, every sermon, every Sunday is important, of course. To me, today's sermon, that you digest it, is hugely important for me. I believe this is actually hugely a pivotal sermon. It's a teaching piece. It's not... I want to equip you with some important understanding. So my reflections today I've borrowed from some other authors who I consider quite brilliant, and that credit needs to be given to that where I've sourced a lot of this material, because I spent a lot of time reading about these things. Eugene Peterson, who wrote many books and is the author of the Message Bible that you read from today, he's one of the sources. Another one of the sources is a man named Keith Matthews. He's a professor of spiritual formation and contemporary culture at the Graduate School of Theology at Azusa Pacific Seminary. And I also have one, Sherry Turkle, who wrote a book called Alone Together: Why We Expect More from Technology and Less from Each Other. She's from MIT, very smart woman, and has put together some very insightful pieces about the crisis and the problem of our culture and what it has to say about how we live and move and grow. which will be made clear in a bit. All three of these writers are asking that here is the basic question for the sermon today. Everything this morning is working from the basic assumption and a question. The question doesn't apply to you, then you can go home. But I think it does apply to all of us to a greater or lesser extent. Here it is. Have you ever asked this question? Why do so many church people feel untransformed? I believe in God, we say. I do my best to honor the teachings of Jesus. And yet, if I'm really honest, why am I stuck in life patterns that I don't want? As a pastor, we often hear this lament, even if it's underneath the surface, just below the surface. Why in their most reflective moments do we hear people say that they feel alone, feel actually misunderstood, disenchanted, or at the very least out of place in regard to their community experience with others, even in the church? And this is a copy of the book. It was published in 2011, I believe. I have heard devout people say this, and they mean it well. I've given up on church. I've heard that. Now, we've all heard the one that I've got no time for this one. The one that says, I'm spiritual. I believe, you know, I'm kind of in God. I'm spiritual, but I got no time for church. I don't like that attitude at all. It's a dysfunctional, it's not thought through. Give me, so normally we'd have a forum following church. Today we're going to drop the forum because we're going to have this wonderful celebration for Anne. And Hugh, I point out, he's all part of that. That attitude I don't like. But here's an attitude I actually am sympathetic with. I understand it. This is a person who's devout, knows God very well, reads their Bible, really reads their Bible. Doesn't say they do, but really does. And are taking their faith journey very seriously and have actually said, I got too much fatigue. I can't do church anymore. I'm kind of done. And I think there's a subtext that there are a number of people who are there. And I want to speak to that. And these authors have been speaking to that. There are many answers to this complex question, but we have to wonder if the church itself hasn't helped to solve this quandary. As one of these writers said, the epidemic of non-community. See, in ages past, people, you know, I go back, I don't know why it's just in my head, John A. Macdonald, right? Lived in Kingston, was a prime minister, all that sort of stuff. But basically, he lived in a community that he could walk around, and there was a community. If he went to Toronto, it was a big deal. But there was community. Today, it's so different. Technology has shaped us and moved us that we've lost this understanding. And it's an important and healthy understanding for our growth. In her thoughtful book called Alone Together, Turkle spends a lot of time describing how technology is affecting all our social institutions and interactions. So the book is actually not a spiritual book. It's just an analysis of culture. But she's on to something, I believe. Our technology creates actually false communities, where we think we are together, but are actually feeling very much alone. I know people who've got a million Facebook friends, but are still pretty alone. And that authentic, deep connecting isn't there. I believe it is a very real disposition for many Christians in the church today. We are not immune. Matthews, the guy, and Peterson, the other author, speak about a culture of hyper-individualism and consumerism. Now, without getting into a big debate, can you just nod with me if you're with me? Do you sense that there's a hyper-individualism in the world? Am I talking to the... No? Yeah? Yeah? Okay. But we're just as guilty as the culture. I really, to a large degree, often we're just about doing our own thing. I might connect with some of my intimate family members, but I'm not going to commit to something like a faith community. Like, okay, yes, if it works for me, if it's convenient, and that's part of the crisis. We have lost the idea that I am a better person and will grow into full maturity, will be the best witness to Jesus Christ when I am part of a genuine and loving community. My experience is that I am a better person when I live in that context with other disciples, people who I'm connected to, who can actually correct me when I've lost my way. You see, community is a critical means for your transformation and mine. And I believe we've lost that muscle memory of what it is, though there's still a dull ache in many a heart. No matter what our particular temperament, so out there, Myers-Briggs personality type. So here's a question. What's your primary community? What is it is the place that you really say it? Because we have all sorts of communities, and I've been throwing this slide up for about a month. I really need to ask you. Gee and I get talking, and some of the Tim Taylor and a few of us, we get chatting away, and it's just like, you're in a crisis, and it's 11 o'clock at night. Who do you call? Who are you going to call? Ghostbusters, right? Now, if Bill Murray showed up, I'd actually be really happy, because Bill Murray just makes me happy. I smile on Bill Murray, right? But Bill Murray ain't going to show up. Who are you going to call? Well, you might phone a family member. Okay, families are fragile, and that's part of it. I need more than that. I need to have a place where I can rely on that. But if I haven't invested in that community, that person may not be there. And that's part of an answer. So when I think of the Myers-Briggs personality types, many of you in business know that they have different personality types. There's ENFP and INTJs and, you know, that all that sort of stuff. Not if you know what I'm talking about, personality sorters, right? So believe it or not, I am an acute introvert, okay? Standing in front of a crowd is not my idea of fun. I know some pastors who are so extroverted, they hunger for it. They love it, right? And I'm going to melt down. Many clergy are actually introverts. Anne's an introvert. And Sunday afternoon, Gee's an introvert. The reason I'm up here is because I believe that what I have to say is of such importance that that's why I'm prepared to risk my emotional well-being. But I have to have a balance in my life. Okay. So when they say, join a small group, join a life group, I mildly get stressed because I go, okay, you need to know that I've been a part of a life group every year of my life since being a Christian, 40 years. And my life group, we've called them compass groups here, we've called them good and beautiful group, we call them whatever group, I don't care what you're studying. I call them ultimately a life group, is what has made me whole and grow. And I can't emphasize this enough, because if you come to church on Sunday and are feeling like, this isn't really meeting me, this isn't quite connecting, maybe the issue is something other than what's going on here. So regardless of your personality type, wisdom says we are social creatures. We are called to community. Sorry, even Aristotle said it, you know, that we are primarily social beings. So I need you and you need me. And you've heard me say this, but I want to land on this even at a deeper level. If anything, the Gospels are beautiful and messy portraits of community where we watch Jesus apprentice a diverse array of disciples as he taught, as he molded, he formed into a community shaped by his agape, shaped by his love. Okay? I mean, you ever wonder why the disciples in the long run were so effective? I mean, a lot of us quickly go, well, they weren't. And yet the church, nurtured from them, grew. I think a lot of people go to the quick answer. Oh, they got anointed by the Holy Spirit. That's true. Acts chapter 2, they got anointed by the Holy Spirit. All of a sudden, they were doing infinitely more than you can ask or imagine. However, we spent 3 years in a small group, day in and day out, not once a week, with Jesus. Imagine that. You're walking for 3 years with the rabbi of rabbis. Talk about molding, shaping, affecting your inner core, and helping you grow. We are designed for community. And the crisis of a hyper-individualistic society runs smack into that. If you doubt that Jesus cared about this, I want you to hear the words. The night before Jesus is taken off to the cross, from John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, he's having his Last Supper. Last Supper, he's with me. I'm just going to read the words to you. A new command I give to you. Love one another. Get on with it. Do it. It's a commandment, not a suggestion. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Do you hear that's what's implied is community? It's understood. When I was 20-something, when I converted to Christianity, I thought that my conversion to Christianity was my intellectual choice and decision. I went, I don't believe in God. I do believe in God. I'm wrestling with God. Is God real? Get over it, Drew. God's real, whether you like it or not. You can debate it all you want, but I'm God and God is real. And I got to a point where I had to go into my living room one day and turned on the stereo and just alone and closed the doors and got on my knees and said, I don't get this, but maybe you are real. And so that was my conversion story. But when I look back at my conversion story, I realized only with hindsight that the community that I was a part of is what converted me more than my intellect, as much as the intellect mattered. So the men's supper group is discussing very intellectual things. Building the case for Christ, being very rational, and why did this happen? It's all important. But I'll tell you what will change a life is that when a person who's seeking God comes into St. John's and goes, these people are different. Your greatest form of evangelism is not being on the street corner going, come to Jesus. If you want to do it, go ahead. That's fine. I'm not telling you not to. The greatest form of evangelism is the community of faith that is so grounded that we are so caring for one another that the visitor walks in and kind of goes, holy smokes, these people, they shall know us by our love. What makes you tick? And then you can quietly say, well, I met this person named Jesus. And you can quietly share that, but it's about us being community. But if you don't enter into that community, then you don't reap the benefit of that. And that's part of the struggle that we at St. John's have, that the church everywhere has. So I put that to you. You see how it all assumes a healthy, authentic, dynamic community when Jesus is talking to his followers. It is through community that we are made whole. It cannot be done on your own. And here is the problem. If the community is dysfunctional, if it is not authentic, the authors I'm reading talk about incarnational communities. I struggle with that, so I said, I don't know what that really means. I mean, incarnation, okay, I can play with that. So I changed it to, what's the word works for me, is authentic community. Really authentic place. How authentic are we? Because if it's not authentic, we will not grow into the maturity that God expects. So quickly turn with me, please, to Ephesians 4, 11 to 13. I'm going to read to you some scripture. If you don't want to open it up, that's fine, but you're going to have to listen even closer. This is actually kind of important. In Ephesians chapter 4, I jump to verse 11. This letter is Paul to the church in Ephesus, and it's a community piece. It's not written to you as an individual. It's written to us as a team. Verse 11. The gifts that he, God, gave were some would be apostles, some would be prophets, some would be evangelists like Billy Graham, some are pastors, some are teachers. So we call this the fivefold ministry of the church. By the way, all of you, do you know who is a pastor in the midst of this flock? Do you know who the pastor is? I hope so. I'm one of the pastors. But I hope you all pastor each other. See, that's the problem. If you think the clergy do all the pastoring, that's part of the dysfunctional community. But a healthy community recognizes that some are called to be apostles, prophets, evangelists. Who's an evangelist in our midst? Oh, I don't do that. Well, unless we get a fivefold ministry right here in River City, we are going to have nothing but trouble. I remember, am I dating myself? Yeah. Rhymes with P and that stands for T and that stands for trouble. Okay, we won't go there. So he calls us, but here's the piece. This fivefold ministry is growing up in our midst, but why does God do this? This is in accordance, verse 11, 12, I lost my place. To equip the saints for the work of ministry. So there's this fivefold ministry here so that you will roll up your sleeves and do work. For why? The building up of you individually? No. Building up the body of Christ until all of us come to unity of faith, the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity. To the full measure, the stature of Christ. The purpose we're here is to grow up and get mature. And as we grow in maturity, we bring others along with us. But we live in a culture that is bombarding you with this notion of individuality. And I am suggesting until we get to the bottom of this, you may well be asking the question, how come I come to church and it's not really meeting me? Maybe we need to understand the depth of community here. So here are a few points that will help us not feel alone together. I love this image of alone together. We're all together, but we're alone. I mean, it's quite a brilliant title for a book. So here are some principles that I want to give you that should ground you in how we do it. Then I'm going to give you an example of how these five work together, and then I'm done. One. These local communities, you call them church, are intensely local. They're intensely local. We're internet-based. Now, you know, I got Facebook and stuff, and that's all well and fine. But when I really need help, it's got to be someone who's down the block or at least a 15-minute car ride away or something. But in order to be healthy, they think this is one of the principles to make it work. There has to have that. Number two, they are face-to-face, or as I like to say, eye-to-eye. It's one of the reasons when I talk to people, I say, don't send me an email. You want to talk to me? You know, if it's something important, phone me. Book an appointment. Come in. Let's spend some time. Let's sit in the same room together and be eye-to-eye, face-to-face. That's where healthy things go. That's where communication happens. Number three, they are enacted through real dialogue and disclosure. There's a vulnerability and an openness in these groups. So think of your life group. Think of a group that you've joined where that openness is there. But a lot of us are reluctant to be that open in a group. So then all of a sudden we're not growing. But we need to be able to provide that openness. And the last one that I want to hear is a clear goal. This is the most important to me. Number five is that they are transformational. They have a clear goal of being transformational. I am meeting with some of the leaders of all our small groups next week. One of the pieces is, you know what's really important? Why are we meeting? Why are you doing a Bible study? Why? Because you want to know more about the Bible? Go to college. I want you to study the Bible so that your life can be transformed. The Bible is incidental. It's a vehicle that helps me get transformed. Do you see the difference? What is the purpose of every group in the church? Let's get together and be a property committee. Ooh, rapture, you know. What is it? Boy, that sounds like a lot of fun. But you know what? Even a property committee, pray together, be together, work together, end up hammering wood together, and end up talking about their life together. And all of a sudden, things become, arguably, transformational. So actually, everything is that important. So let me give you an example. These five principles have just not been made up. I mean, the people who write about this stuff do massive pieces of formation. Your monastic communities are grounded in this. Maybe you've heard me say this before, but I've encountered people who found AA more spiritual than church. Nod with me if you've heard that, right? Why? Well, let's pretend we're a member of an AA group or a 12-step group. They are local. People gather together in the church basement. They have partners. They know who they're going to phone at 11 o'clock at night when I got a problem because that bottle of whiskey right in front of me is scaring me and I need that and I'm going to go, I need help. See, we're not meant to do it alone. I will discipline myself. Well, you may not have a problem with alcohol, but in your spiritual walk, there are all sorts of things that will make you limp. Maybe you need to call somebody. Who's your prayer partner? Y'all got a prayer partner? No. You should. You need to have a person who you're covenanted with and walking with. That's what they do in AA. Good 12-step group also is clear. It's face-to-face. It's eye-to-eye. There is real dialogue and vulnerability. Hi, my name's Joe, and I'm an alcoholic. When you stand up in an AA meeting, you say that. Do you realize how hard that must be? To be that open and that vulnerable? And you know what the brilliance of AA is? Is that everybody in the group goes, hi, Joe, so are we. We love you. All's good. So there's love and there's trust. So he can be open. Well, I'm hoping, does that kind of stuff happen at St. John's York Mill? When you get into a group, your Tuesday morning group or your Wednesday night group or whatever group you're in, are you really that vulnerable? Are you really that open where then we can pray for each other and grow? I tell you, if we commit ourselves to these five principles as individuals and within this community, it will transform this whole body. It will transform also your Sunday worship experience. And that's what God wants, so that we can to grow with it. By the way, one of the things that I find is that 12-step groups are not 12 weeks. Okay? We're going to study this book. How many weeks are we studying this book? Okay. 8 weeks, 12 weeks, 13 weeks. I don't care. When that book's done, I'm going to start a new one. It's going to be the Bible. Let's go through Matthew. I don't care what you're studying almost. We need to get focused in this regard. And just so you know, the 12 steps were all grounded by the church, eh? Episcopal Church in New York City, priests, that's where they came from. In AA, everybody's got a sponsor. When you were baptized, you had a sponsor. That sponsor was there for you. We've, in our mainline church land, we just changed it and we made it godparents. And I've had people come to me and say, well, the godparent, they're just really nice people. Something happens to us, we want our child to go with the godparent. Does godparent know God? No. Then why do you want that person as a godparent? I need a godparent who, when I'm not bringing my children to church, phones me and says, McDonald, what are you doing? How come your kids aren't in church? See, there's accountability. But we don't like that kind of accountability. But I'll tell you, if we all did it, we would find our lives were in fact transformed, and we would find worship and coming to church infinitely of a greater joy. I've got too many other qualifiers. I'm going to wrap that up there. I'm not saying good things don't happen on Facebook. I know people who find very meaningful conversations and dialogues on blogs. They are meaningful. But I fear they're just intellectual or just concepts, and that something in the gap gets missed, where there's prayer, caring. And that's what we're called to be as the community of faith. May God bless you as we love one another as Jesus commanded, in a manner that is truly in keeping with the gospel. It's done in community. God bless you as you walk.